everyone.
I'm Elena Doty, and I'm here today with Konstantin Mandrika. We're engineers on the Firebase Crashlytics team, and we wanted to share some recent work that Crashlytics has done to improve support for apps built with Flutter. So, we were sitting in the office one day, looking for an answer to the perennial question, how's the weather outside? Instead of looking out the window, we explored the massive number of already available weather apps. None of them were really quite the right amount of perfect, so we decided to build our own.
Luckily for us, Flutter makes writing natively compiled multi-platform apps quick and easy. Within hours, we'd released a beautiful, perfect app and could leave the office, now that we knew whether to bring an umbrella. But the next morning, we were greeted with a flurry of negative reviews, wrong weather, stuck flows, even a crash or two. What happened? It would have been nice if we had been notified of these problems in our app by something other than negative customer reviews. Of course, the earlier an emerging problem is detected, the quicker it can be fixed, leading to fewer unhappy customers.
It seems like it's too late for that, though. At this point, it would be helpful to at least know the extent of the problems and to see how many of our users are being impacted by them. Knowing that the app is unstable is just the beginning of the battle. Somehow, we'll also need to pinpoint where in our code all these issues are coming from, then figure out how to fix them.
But, as luck would have it, we both work on a crash reporter and know exactly what this app needs. For those of you that aren't familiar, Firebase Crashlytics is a leading mobile crash reporter that helps you achieve the full stability potential of your app. And now, the full range of Crashlytics features is available to apps built with Flutter. Crashlytics is just one piece of the Firebase suite of tools. While Crashlytics will help us ensure the stability of our app, the rest of Firebase can help it grow and succeed. The first step in getting our weather app back on track is integrating Crashlytics. Think back to the last time you discovered a promising new tool, only to realize that the setup process was an astonishing 16 steps. We can sympathize. Not only is this frustrating, it's also very error-prone. This is why we spent a lot of time simplifying the setup of Firebase and Crashlytics as much as possible. Getting up and running should be quick and painless.
The setup process for Flutter apps differs a bit from their native Android and iOS counterparts. Instead of creating an app in the Firebase console, then downloading a Google Services file and dropping it into the appropriate directory in our project, we'll use the Flutterfire CLI tool so that all we need to do is initialize Firebase directly in our app's Dart code. Before integrating Crashlytics into our weather app, we need to install the Flutterfire CLI tool and run configure. Then, we'll include the generated firebase-options.dart file in our app, call firebase.initializeApp, and we're good to go. This is not only much simpler and less error-prone, it also allows for greater runtime flexibility. For example, using different Firebase app configurations for different environments or custom builds of the app. Crashlytics supports Dart-only initialization as well.
Once our app is set up to use Firebase, getting the benefit of Crashlytics is as easy as adding the dependency via the Flutter pub add command. This looks simple, right? However, behind the scenes, this instruments the iOS target to automatically upload the appropriate symbol files that Crashlytics needs to translate iOS stack traces into something that is human readable. On Android, apps that aren't taking advantage of obfuscation are good to go at this point as well. If you are using obfuscation, configuring the project to upload the code mapping files on every build automatically is straightforward and just requires adding a few lines to the corresponding Gradle build files. The Firebase docs outline how to do this in detail.
With symbol and mapping files automatically taken care of, we just need to rebuild the app. As Konstantin mentioned, adding Crashlytics to a Flutter app configured with Firebase now requires just a single step. At this point, our weather app is set up correctly. We'll automatically receive the rare Flutter framework and native Android and iOS crashes. However, the most interesting bugs are within the app's business logic. After all, a never-ending spinner or showing the wrong weather suggests problems with the code that we wrote, not some systemic OS bug that we just happened to hit. Business logic errors such as these are often the most impactful problems within an app, and need to be addressed urgently.
Such errors are very intuitive on Android and iOS because they cause the app to crash. These errors are considered fatal and are captured automatically on native platforms. For less impactful situations, Crashlytics also has an API that lets the developer log exceptions that are expected and don't crash the app. Crashlytics Flutter users were previously limited to using the non-fatal API for all Flutter bugs, making it hard to determine their priority. We've addressed this problem by introducing a new API that allows you to report high-priority issues as fatal in the same manner that a crash is reported on native Android and iOS apps. Since the Flutter framework is set up in a way where an uncaught exception may not lead to a crash, we wanted to let you, the developer, determine what is high priority. The new API has two functions. One operates on a Flutter error details object, while the other allows the developer to specify the error and stack trace. These two functions provide the maximum flexibility for all error scenarios.
Going back to our weather app, we'll take advantage of the new API to log all top-level, unhandled exceptions as fatal. FlutterError.onError is Flutter's uncaught exception mechanism that provides a registered callback function with a Flutter error details object describing what the problem is. With this addition, anytime an uncaught exception occurs, it'll be logged to Crashlytics. Our app fetches the weather via asynchronous HTTP calls. And in order to catch unexpected errors in these calls, we've made use of Dart's error zones. We'll go ahead and log all exceptions that occur within these zones as fatal. Catching errors in error zones, and with FlutterError.onError, casts a wide net. It's often useful to track specific error-prone scenarios as well. In our case, we want to make sure that the URL our app is referencing for weather data is valid, since it's constructed using user-supplied input.
While we're here, we'll also log some non-fatal scenarios that we think are likely causing issues. Specifically, we suspect that we may need to ask the user for permission before querying their coordinates via system APIs. A good rule of thumb for using fatal exceptions and non-fatal exceptions is to map them to unexpected and expected events. In the case of our app, anything that propagates to a top-level exception handler is unexpected and should be recorded as fatal. Most existing try-catch blocks are logged as non-fatal, though we do have some fatals. It's up to you to determine what works best for your app. Instrumenting our app with these few Crashlytics API calls provides a large breadth of error coverage and serves as a good starting point in our debugging journey.
Thinking back a little bit, notice that we said report high priority issues instead of record high priority issues. That was intentional. On traditional platforms, restarting the application after a crash triggers the sending of a report to Crashlytics. This is necessary for various technical reasons, especially on iOS and Android NDK. But since Flutter errors don't usually lead to a crash, the time between a problem occurring and an app restart can be long. This motivated us to make the new fatal API on demand. In other words, as soon as you log a high priority event using the new API, it'll be immediately sent to the Crashlytics backend for processing, and will show up in the dashboard almost instantaneously.
Since high priority events are treated in the exact same way as standard Android and iOS crashes, we can take advantage of Crashlytics' early alert system, Velocity Alerts. Velocity Alerts can easily be set up and configured in the Crashlytics console. We can choose to receive emails about new alerts or integrate with third-party services. We'll stick with just emails for now. And configure alerting to start when 1% of all user sessions are affected by an issue. This will help notify us of high-impact, emerging app problems that are affecting many customers. Having taken advantage of the new APIs to record exceptions as fatal, and having set up velocity alerts to alert us of high-impact emerging problems, we released a new version of our app.
Within minutes, we got our first alert. It's a nerdy thing to be excited about, maybe. But this is the first step towards figuring out what the impactful problems in our app are. Each Velocity Alerts email has a link to the specific issue in the Crashlytics dashboard that prompted it. That issue is where we'll start our investigation into just where the problems in our code are hiding. Looks like our weather app isn't validating the zip code correctly. From the stack trace, we can see that an exception is being logged when we try to validate the URL, one of the scenarios we chose to log as fatal earlier. Choosing to log this exception as fatal also means that users who experience it count against our crash free users metric. This metric tells us what percentage of users have not experienced a crash. Because our invalid URL exception is considered fatal, the crash free users percentage will decrease accordingly each time a new user runs into it. Our zip code validation mix-up happens to be a straightforward problem. Unfortunately, not all issues are going to be this simple to solve. Some end up being extremely tricky to track down.
Some are downright frustrating, such as when a system or Flutter framework frame is highlighted, and you know it just can't possibly be the problem. We got your back. We've done quite a bit of work to revamp our analysis engine. For example, we've added a number of heuristics that deprioritize frames that are unlikely to lead to a crash. And as a consequence, we've improved how crashes are grouped together, providing a more accurate insight into your app's stability and allowing you to triage, prioritize, and fix issues faster. In our case, better grouping helped expose the multitude of distinct problems that the users of our weather app were running into, giving us a better sense of just how broken the app is.
In service of all these improvements, we've, of course, revamped our docs. Not only the content of the docs, but their discoverability. All of the Flutter docs have been moved into the same place as the Android and iOS docs, firebase.google.com/docs. Check them out. We've added many new code snippets and useful guides to help you build the best app yet. And in case you come upon a question that the docs can't answer, don't worry. The Firebase support team is now ramped up to tackle the most difficult of questions. Feel free to reach out.
As Elena and I found out the hard way, even experienced developers write bugs. Thankfully, we no longer have to rely on bad reviews to know if our app is crashing, or on trial and error to figure out where in the code we messed up. Now that we know how to make reliable, stable apps, the possibilities are endless. Maybe we'll make a chat app next. So whether you're experienced with Flutter development or are just starting out, we're excited for you to give Crashlytics a try within your Flutter app. With the new simplified onboarding process, getting started is easier than ever. We've done a lot of work to ensure that the large range of Crashlytics features are fully supported in apps built with Flutter, and we're looking forward to hearing your feedback. Go to firebase.google.com/docs to get started, and be on the lookout for future technical blog posts. Thanks.